My name is Sam Vaknin, and I'm the author of Malignant Self-Love, Narcissism Revisited. The ancient institution of monogamous marriage is ill-suited to the exigencies of modern Western civilization. People of both genders simply live longer, which renders monogamy highly impracticable. People travel far, travel away, frequently. They are exposed to thousands of tempting romantic alternatives, also via social networking. So in an age of malignant individualism, bordering on narcissism, men and women alike put themselves, their fantasies, and their needs first. All else, including the family, be damned. And with 5 decades of uninterrupted prosperity and feminism women's lib, most of the female denizens of the West have acquired the financial wherewithal to realize their dreams at the expense and to the detriment of collectives that they ostensibly belong to, like the nuclear family. Owing to the dramatic doubling of life expectancy, modern marriages seem to go through 3 phases. Infatuation, or the honeymoon phase, procreation-accumulation, in which assets, children, and shared experiences are amassed and amalgamated, and exhaustion-outsourcing, bonding with new emotional and sexual partners for rejuvenation, or the fulfillment of long-repressed fantasies, needs, and wishes. Divorces and breakups occur mostly at the seams, the periods of transition between these phases, and especially between the stages of accumulation-procreation and exhaustion-outsourcing. That is, where the family breaks down. So, with marriage on the decline and infidelity on the rise, the reasonable solution would be polyamory, households with multiple partners of both genders, all of whom are committed to one another for the long haul, romantically involved, sexually shared, economically united. Alas, while perfectly rational as a development of traditional marriage and one that is best suited for modernity, polyamory is an emotionally unstable arrangement, what with romantic jealousy ineluctably rearing its ugly head. Very few people are willing to share their spouse with other people. So human psychology dictates that in any modern, adaptable variant of marriage, monogamy must be preserved, while allowing for emotional, sexual, and romantic diversity. How to square this circle? How to reconcile these contradictory demands? Enter time-limited marriages. These are marriage contracts with expiration dates, 1 to 3 years for childless couples and a minimum of 7 years for those blessed with children, to allow the parents to provide a stable environment during the child's formative years. These contracts can be allowed to expire, and then the parties are free to look elsewhere for the fulfillment of their sexual, emotional, and romantic dreams and wishes. Or these contracts can be renewed and renegotiated in the process. The question is not why there are so many divorces, but why are there so few of them? Surely serial monogamy, in effect a tawdry variant of time-limited marriages, is far better, fairer, and more humane than adultery. Couples stay together and tolerate staying strained, tolerate infidelity, cheating, owing to a variety of motivations, inertia, financial or emotional dependence, insecurity, lack of self-confidence, low self-esteem, fear of the unknown, and the tedium of dating. Some couples persevere owing to religious conviction, for the sake of appearances, or the children. Yet others make a smooth transition to an alternative lifestyle, so they engage in polyamory, swinging, or consensual adultery. Indeed, what has changed is not the incidence of adultery, even among women. There are good grounds to assume that adultery has remained the same throughout human history, in incidence and prevalence as well. The phenomenon, quantitatively and qualitatively, has been always the same, merely underreported. What has changed are the social acceptability of extramarital sex, both before and during marriage, and the case of obtaining the ease of obtaining divorce. people discuss adultery openly, where before it was a taboo topic. People divorce more often. Another new development may be the rise of selfish affairs among women younger than 35 who are used to multiple sexual partners. Selfish affairs are acts of adultery whose sole purpose is to satisfy sexual curiosity and the need for romantic diversity. The emotional component in these usually short-term affairs, one-night stands and the like, is muted. Among women older than 60, adultery has become the accepted way of seeking emotional connection and intimacy outside the stale marital bond. And these, put together, are outsourcing affairs. Within a time-limited marriage, partners would have little incentive to cheat. They could simply wait for the contract to lapse. The looming expiry would also keep the intimate partners on their toes and on their best behavior by generating a semi-paternal environment of courtship and positive sexual tension. The periodically renegotiated marriage contract would reflect changing economic realities and in the fortunes of the partners, shifts in romantic sentiment, and other pertinent new data regarding the two members of the couple. Of course, time-limited marriages would eliminate the need for divorces, except in extreme emergency cases. So why not adopt this as the solution to cheating and divorce?